Good morning, students. I am Dr. Tripti Gupta from Shiv Jyoti Education Group, Kota. So, welcome to the English class. Today, we are going to take up chapter number 5 from Hornbill, The Ailing Planet, The Green Moment's Role, written by Naini Palkhiwala. Now, let us look about some information about Naini Palkhiwala, who he is. So, let us look about the author here. So, students, let us look about the author here, Naini Palkhiwala. Naini Palkhiwala was an Indian economist and jurist. He was one of the leading interpreters of the constitutional law and was also known for his book, Law and Practice of Income Tax, which he co-authored with his mentor, Sir Jamshedji Khanga. Now, as we can see here about Naini Palkhiwala, he wrote an article in Indian Express. So, here, so students, now let us start discussing this chapter here, The Ailing Planet, The Green Moment's Role, written by Naini Palkhiwala. We have already discussed about Naini Palkhiwala. Now, he has written an article which was published in Indian Express on 24th November in 1994. The issues that he raised regarding the declining health of the earth continue to have relevance even today. So, now let us see what were the key content and the aspects which were being covered in this article being written in the year 1994. Now, as we can see here, so the chapter is basically dealing with the ailing planet. The planet which is being referred here is our Mother Earth, and the ailing aspect, that means it is deteriorating, the health of this planet is deteriorating, it is getting ill, that is why there are lot of ailments, lot of things which are making its health to be deteriorated. So, that is what is the major issue or the concern which Naini Palkhiwala has, he has shared in this particular article which was published in Indian Express. Now, this green movements which are being the part of the title of this chapter, these green movements are those measures, campaigns, movements which were being taken in different parts of the world, and we can say any movement which has been taken up in the world never had been so successful, and they did not pick up in the common mass. The common mass did not accepted those movements in such a with such an enthusiasm as was the green movement. So, because people understood the viewpoint, why this green movement is being required, and the first green movement started in New Zealand in the year 1972. So, let us start here. That, see here, one cannot recall any movement in the world history which has gripped the imagination of the entire human race so completely and so rapidly as the Green Movement, which started nearly 25 years ago in 1972. The world's first nationwide Green Party was founded in New Zealand. Since then, the movement has not looked back. So, that's what I was been discussing with you, that the Green Movement, there was a Green Party which was being organized, it was being founded in year 1972 in New Zealand, and from there the movement picked up and it never, nobody never looked back while or reviewing the need of that green movement. So, finally, this green movement was the concept which was been taken up by various countries in the world. So now we have also shifted one hopes irrevocably from the mechanistic view of to a holistic and ecological view of the world. Now see here, there is a phrase being used, a holistic and ecological view. Now what this comparison is been, what this shift is been talked here is that people and the complete population of the world has been having a very mechanistic view of leading lives. They were been focusing more on the growth and development of human beings, and their personal growth and development was the key focus for the countries, for the population. But now they have as we were discussing a holistic and ecological view. Now this holistic view means a complete and comprehensive view of ecology which takes into account all species of present in this world. So that is what is the holistic view. So what this shift has been, why this shift has been required, because we were being very self-centered and we developed this mechanistic view over the generations, and that view, that focus of the man has been the reason for the deterioration of the health of this planet. Now this shift is required so that we can bring back the health of our Mother Earth with this, by adopting a holistic and ecological view in the complete world. It is a shift in human perception as revolutionary as, so this became a revolutionary shift. Everywhere in the world, human population started thinking about shifting their focus, their perception towards the utilization of resources, towards the various presence of various species, conservation of environment. So that is how this shift started coming into the various activities which the human beings, they were been taking up in different parts of the world. So there was a concept being introduced by Copernicus, who taught mankind in 16th century that the earth and the other planets revolve around the sun. So this concept, this shift came before Copernicus concept, which was being given for the solar system, that the planets, they revolve around the sun. Before that, the thought process or the perception was that the sun revolves around the planet. Whereas in reality, when Copernicus gave this concept that it is the planets who revolve around the sun. So for the first time in human history, there is a growing worldwide consciousness that the earth itself is a living organism, an enormous being of which we are parts. So here there is a concept that he gave a concept of this green movement was being built up, or they were being developed with the concept of considering the Mother Earth to be a big organism, and we all species are, and as well as human beings also, are the part of that bigger organism. And now that is why we consider the health of that Mother Earth is being deteriorating because of the various activities, various industrialization activities like deforestation and various other reasons for which are responsible for that deterioration. Now it has its own metabolic needs and vital processes which need to be respected and preserved. Now the concept with which we have taken up the or considered it to be an organism. Now, as an organism, if we consider the Mother Earth, then it has its own metabolic needs. That means it has its own processes, and the way it regulates the Mother Nature, that it revives itself. Okay, and there are certain vital processes which are vital, means something very important, okay, very significant. So those important processes are, should be, we have to conserve them, we have to preserve them in the manner they are to be taken up and they are to be further processed in the Mother Nature. So finally, this concept was being given, and the people and the various, the governments, the NGOs and the mass public, everybody, they started bringing this shift and understanding this concept. The Earth's vital signs reveal a patient is declining health. The Earth's vital signs reveal a patient in declining health. We have begun to realize our ethical obligations to be good stewards of the planet and responsible trustees of the legacy to future generations. Now, that is what exactly we need to do. What we need to do is, we have understood that there are various signs, symptoms which is are being shown by the various features of the Mother Earth, that it has become a patient. The Mother Earth has become a patient. It has become ill and it has a declining. So we have begun to realize, what realization we have made about the our ethical obligations, that we have certain obligations, we have certain responsibilities towards our Mother Nature, and for that reason, because we need to be good stewards. Stewards means those people who help or who serve the Mother Nature. Okay, so as stewards, as the people who are serving them, we need to understand that we have certain obligations, responsibilities, and as the, we need to be the trustees of the legacy to future generation. That means what exactly we are going to give our future generations, what they are going to inherit from us. That is also, we should be the responsible trustees of that inheritance which we are going to give to our future generations, because whatever we are going to leave will be inherited to our future generations. So if we are giving them a patient, a earth, a planet with the declining health, certainly the future generations will keep on struggling with this declining planet. And that is what we need to understand, that here this is our moral duty to finally make all those damages to be repaired by us before we transfer, we give this planet as a legacy to our future generation. Now, there is another concept which is coming up here, that is we are going to talk about, is the concept of sustainable development, was popularized in 1987 by World Commission on Environment and Development. So the World Commission on Environment and Development, in 1987, they gave a concept of sustainable development to the world. Now, what this sustainable development is all about? We have to understand the definition of this sustainable development. Now, what it says is a legal way of, basically it is the how we utilize our resources in a manner that we satisfy the needs of the existing generation of this present population in such a manner that the resources do not get deteriorated or depleted and they are being conserved for the future generation also. So that is what is sustainable development. Now let us look here how the author has described about the sustainable development. In its report, it defined the idea as development that meets the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their needs. Now, what it is talking about of two generations, two set of needs. Now, first set of needs are meeting development which meets the needs of the present. So, first of all, meeting the needs, not the wants, not desires. He is talking about only basic needs. So, we should focus and we should shift our perception for meeting out the needs rather than wants and desires. Okay, without compromising. So, in such a manner that we should not compromise the ability of future generations to meet their needs. So, the resources should be utilized in such a manner that the future generations, their share should not be exploited by us, the present generation, in a manner that we do not leave anything for them. So, without stripping the natural world of resources future generations would need. So, that is what we are being, up till now we were not being hardly taking care of this particular aspect. So, that is how this concept of sustainable development was being given, so that the various economies, the countries, their governments should look about, should bring this concept of sustainable development while practicing various kinds of activities through which we are utilizing the natural resources. Now, in the next paragraph here in this chapter, the author has made a sarcasm. Now, in that sarcasm, he has tried to show us the real picture of ours, that is how the human being is. Now, he has quoted in the zoo in Lusaka, Zambia, there is a cage where the notice reads the world's most dangerous animal. So, in the zoo, there is a cage and in that cage, the name which is being tagged there, that is the world's most dangerous animal. And what's inside that cage is the most dangerous animal. So, inside that cage, there is no animal but a mirror. So, where you see yourself. So, when you see yourself in the mirror, then you realize that you, the human being, is the most dangerous animal of the world. Why so? Because we are capable of destroying whatsoever has been given to us by Mother Nature. Maybe the species, maybe the wildlife, maybe the ecological imbalances which we are creating, deteriorating the health of the complete planet. So, in this manner, we have to understand that this sarcasm of the people, the zoo authorities, where they have made us to realize that we are the most dangerous people. Thanks to the efforts of a number of agencies in different countries, a new awareness has now dawned upon the most dangerous animal in the world. So, that's what exactly is going on. That is what's the shift which has been brought in the various countries where people are now realizing that being a dangerous animal is not going to serve our future generation. So, we have to bring a paradigm shift over here. So, he has realized the wisdom of shifting from a system based on domination to one based on partnership. So basically, up till now, the human being, they were being dominating and exploiting the planet. Now there has to be a shift, there has to be a shift, paradigm shift, and the system has to understand the complete human being has to work on a partnership. That means a partnership with nature, a partnership with the other species of the world. Scientists have cataloged about 1.4 million living species with which mankind shares the earth. Estimates vary widely as regards the still uncatalogued living species. Biologists reckon that about 3 to 100 million other living species still languish and unnamed in ignominious darkness. So, what exactly is this paragraph has been saying us? That there are somewhere around 1.4 million living species which are already being classified by the various biologists in the different parts of the world. And still it has been estimated that somewhere around 100 million more living species are yet to be classified by the biologists. So, and what exactly are being here, that is, there is a word being used here, languish, that means withered or vanished. So, still they are being, there are various living species which still vanish unnamed in the darkness. They are being infamous and igneous darkness means they are not being even identified, and before being identified, before being acknowledged and their presence is being classified, even before that they will vanish off from this world. So, this is what is the impact of human domination on this world. So, now let us move ahead with the article here and let's see what it has been sharing with us in this last paragraph on this page. So, one of the early international commissions which dealt inter alia with the question of ecology and environment was the Brandt Commission, which had a distinguished Indian as one of its members, Mr. L.K. Jha. The first Brandt report raised the question, are we to leave our successors a scorched planet of advancing deserts, improvised landscapes and ailing environment? So, this was the question which was being raised by Mr. L.K. Jha, who was the member of Brandt Commission, and he represented India over there in that commission. And there he raised this question, and what the question is, that are we to leave our successors, the future generations, what we are going to leave for them? A scorched planet, a planet which has already been exploited of and which has been scorching means something which is basically burnt. Okay, and here the advancing deserts, burnt and advancing deserts means here that it has been expanding. The deserts are expanding because we are been over utilizing the croplands, the grasslands, and because of that over utilization and exploitation of these natural areas, these natural, the land, the mother earth, we are making it to be advancing towards deserts. impoverished landscapes, those landscapes which are been now been poor, they have just deteriorated in their health because of our activities, and ailing environment, an environment which has already been deteriorated, it has depleted in its vital signs, and that kind of ailing environment, are we going to give this as a legacy to our future generation? That is what the question was being raised by Mr. L.K. Jha. Mr. Lester R. Brown, in his thoughtful book, The Global Economic Prospect, points out that the Earth's principal biological systems are four: fisheries, forests, grasslands, and croplands. And they form the foundation of the global economic system. So, what here is being talked about by Mr. Lester R. Brown, that the complete global economy of the world is being comprising of the four ecosystems. The economy is being based, the foundation of that global economy are the ecosystems. These biological systems are the ecosystems, and they are of four types. Basically, first one, fisheries. Fisheries, we understand those sea areas, those areas in our oceans and seas where there are lot of fishes, they are in abundance, and there the fishing activities are being taken up. So, those are fisheries. Forests, we understand grasslands and the croplands. Croplands, the farms where we cultivate the crops. And finally, on the basis, these are the foundation. On these biological systems, we are being based, all our economic activities are somehow in one or the other manner are based on these biological systems. So,